I mean, this talk, I would probably discuss less the content of the library rather than the general context and how we decided to start and how it works how creating a library actually works. So maybe to first, I would like to briefly remind what we are talking about when we talk about gamma ray and multi-messenger astronomy in this specific context. So we are looking at extreme particle accelerator in the universe, which can produce usually extremely energetic particles, ions, protons, electrons, that will interact with the ambient medium, magnetic fields or matter, and will produce secondary particles, not charged particles like photons and neutrinos that will reach Earth. So typically, we will be here observing across the whole electromagnetic spectrum from the radio up to the gamma rays. And here, of course, we're interested in the high energy part, so the gamma rays, which basically we split into two domains, the high energy gamma rays, which reach up to 10 to the 11 electron volts, and the very high energy gamma rays, which goes from 10 to the 11 to 10 to the 15 electron volts, more or less. So those are very broad energy ranges, which you typically observe photons one by one, and which require either space-based instrumentation, like the Fermi. So here you see the Fermi telescope, which is a high energy gamma ray instrument that was launched in 2008. And you have then ground-based instruments. So here you see the Cherenkov telescope array, which is the coming major instrument that will be, that is currently starting to be deployed and will be operational by the mid-20s. And in parallel, another channel of interaction will produce high energy neutrinos that can be detected as well. And there are current experiments running in the Mediterranean or in the Antarctic ice shelf to look at the interaction of those very high energy neutrinos. And all those channels are very important to really pinpoint the actual processes at play. So, gamma ray astronomy and even more multi-messenger astronomy really requires some kind of interoperability between instruments, because of course you need to combine the informations of many different observatories. And this practice of interoperability is really in the culture of astronomy or in the astronomical community. So that's why, for instance, the gamma ray data from the Fermi Observatory are public, the software are public, but it's not the case for the highest energy part, for which we will see the situation is more complex, and that's one of the motivation of gamma prime. So briefly, so the principle of a measurement there is that a gamma ray will reach the atmosphere, create a pair of electron positron there, and the pair will then cascade into a full shower. This electromagnetic shower will produce a kind of ultraviolet radiation called the Cherenkov radiation, which we can measure thanks to very fast electronic and large telescopes on the ground. And so you will produce images of the interaction of a gamma ray in the atmosphere, and that's what you are measuring. So now today, gamma ray astronomy is on the ground. The ground-based gamma ray astronomy is really a global effort with many different observatories and experiments. There are three major ones which are, active since the early 2000s and mid 2000s. This is the ACE experiment in Namibia, the Veritas in the US, and MAGIC in the Canary Island, and those are based on the Cherenkov radiation telescope principle, and there are other instrument as well, the Hawk and the Lasso, which are measuring directly the particles in their detector. So not the chain of emission of the particles, but directly the particles in some, specifically designed instrument like water tanks in the Hawk system, for instance. So there's a variety of designs, a variety of instruments. And in the near future, of course, we will have a major instrument which will gather a large fraction of the community. So the current situation regarding data formats and tools is a bit complex because basically all instruments have their own proprietary data format and their own proprietary tool. They are usually all based on the open software route, which is developed by CERN. But all internal formats and all the codes are really developed inside collaboration and they are not openly available. So basically it means that each process, data reduction process from the raw data to the high level science product is fully parallel between the different experiments. Even in one single experiment, you can have several parallel implementation that are completely not reusable and not interoperable. So the current situation really prevents completely the interoperability and the reusability of the data. So it really means that something is needed to have common open data formats and common open tools to be able to really take this into into account. So one thing that has been required in view of the CTA effort is really to understand the data flow, to really separate what is instrument-specific data treatment to the more general use cases and method. And basically, we came up with this scheme where you start from data. So we talk about data level, and you have the basic data levels, which is uncalibrated images from the cameras, which are then calibrated. And then you apply some specific treatment to reconstruct the images into an incident particle or the characteristics of an incident particle. And then you can apply some filtering on the characteristic in order to recover really to distinguish the gamma rays from the rest of the cosmic ray particles, which you are not interested in. And in the end, you obtain filtered events, so we call them gamma-like events, which are basically a list of events with a position in the sky and an energy and a time. And so this is really the part that becomes very general, where the first steps are really instrument specific. This part becomes really instrument general, common to most of the instruments. So that's where you can really define a global format. And after that, you can then provide general tools for most of the users to be able to perform the high-level treatments, to produce reduced data sets, spectra, images, maps, and then even higher-level products like catalogs or fluxes, light curves, and so on and so forth. So that's the idea that we have for the GammaPy package, where we want to provide a Python package for gamma ray astronomy, which is based on some common data formats and which is flexible so that it can be reused by different experiments, that is open source, of course, that anybody can access it, and which is community driven with the input of people from different experiments possibly. And we chose to rely on Python and the Python ecosystem because it provides a lot of open developed software. And this then can be proposed as a prototype for the CTA science tools as well. So the first part, of course, is to have common data formats. And so in the mid 2010, seeing the issue, the long-standing issue of the data formats, there was a community initiative to try to provide some open formats for gamma ray astronomy. So it's the so-called Gamma Ray Astro Data Format Initiative. It consisted of members of the Fermilab consortium and several ground-based instruments. And it ended up in producing a prototype format based on the FITS file system. And this format has been used already for a number of data production inside CTA, for instance. The S experiment has provided a small test data release consisting of about 50 or 60 observations. And this format is described. It's described on a GitHub repository with a number of things regarding events, instrument response function, and more. Higher level products as well. So now I can come to the Gamma Pi concept. So it's really a Python library within the Python ecosystem. So the main dependency are the well-tested and open libraries, NumPy, SciPy, and for the AstroPy community, the astronomy community, sorry, the AstroPy library, which allows the handling of sky coordinates, of physical quantities, and fits in input-output, and so on and so forth. And then we, of course, we rely on other things like the iMinui or Sherpa or EMC for the minimizer systems, the matplotlib for visualization, Jupyter, and a number of other systems. The library is relatively lightweight, and we make sure that it stays so. So we try to keep a minimal call duplication, and we try to have relatively clear and clean code base, so that it's easily understandable by others. So there are typically 40,000 lines of code, and a large fraction of that is dedicated to unit tests, for which we try to maintain a good coverage for the quality and stability of the code. And of course, a large fraction of that is also documentation and tutorials. Of course, for an open source tool like this one, you need to make a special effort on documentation, because if you want to attract people to use it. So we rely on the GitHub environment for the development, and for the distribution, we use mostly the Conda environment, and of course you can obtain it from pip as well. As I said, the documentation is a very important part. So we have this, we have a large number of tutorials based on Jupyter notebooks and a lengthy description of the API as well. To ensure quality, we also monitor the performance and we check the high-level products quality, comparing the current state of the code with published results. So we have this we have a special repository which performs continuous checks of the performances and of the scientific stability of the results. So a few words on the how we perform the or we work on the development, because such a project is a bit peculiar in the sense that it's not specifically an initiative of an experiment. So we came up with some ideas, and we were several wanting to to change a bit the current approach, and so we gathered efforts and we tried to get more people into the effort from various places. And so it took time to have a stable base of developers and contributors, and we had to we basically had two stage in the development. Initially, we basically opened the contribution to any kind of input so that the code increased, and began to be not very enough organized. And so at some point, mid-2018 and later, we changed completely the system. We introduced really a roadmap for the development and a stronger development, supervision of the development by the lead developers. So that's why you see the continuous increase in the number of line of code, and then a brutal decrease and basically stability afterwards. And you see that we managed to reach a level of 8 to 10 regular contributors over the last 2.5 years. And contributors are mostly younger people, PhD and postdocs, for whom there is a strong interest in using this kind of tool. So in parallel to their work, usually they also provide some developments for Gamma Prime. We also had to structure a bit the organization of the project. So we basically, this was needed to improve the interaction with the experiment and the observatories, and to ensure a more organized and planned development. So basically we have an organ coordination committee with a representative of several labs, which contribute regularly to the development. And we have two project managers, one from the APC and one from Erlangen, and two lead developers. And then we have about 10 regular contributors. And in total, since the beginning, we have about 80 contributors that have participated in Gamma Pi. One tool that we've introduced, similarly to what is done in the other Python environment, is really to use we call them pigs for proposal for improvement of Gamma Pi. It's very similar to the ape for AstroPy proposal of enhancement, and pep is for Python. I mean, it's a general practice where you basically propose a plan, it's a short text, then it's commented by the developers, then we ask for feedback from the coordination committee, and then once it's approved, we really start the implementation and try to share a bit the task into a smaller task than people can tackle easily. And I mean, the major search thing was, for instance, defining the roadmap to the version 1, which we are about to finish, hopefully. One very useful thing for developers is to organize this kind of coding sprints where you can really gather people together, where you can pair code to really help people learning how to work with this kind of tool, and then you can really do some mentoring, and it's usually very efficient to get people really understanding the API and start developing it. We used to do it physically, and this year we've done a large number of them, but completely remotely. It's less efficient, but still it works a bit. So maybe to conclude, I just wanted to show one example of this. So of course, if we start to have data formats, we start to have tools, but we still don't have public data, which is of course a major impediment in the field to really take most of this kind of effort. But still, the various experiments start to use this kind of tool and to convert their data into this format. Maybe one day they will put whole, their whole database public. It's not yet there. CTA will, but it's not, I mean, it's still for not before a few years. But this effort is still interesting because it shows that you can perform a fully reproducible and multi-instrument gamma ray analysis. So that's something that we've that is completely available from the GitHub repository. And all the data, the scripts, and the notebooks are provided. And the reproducibility is ensured by the Conda distribution for if you want to execute it locally or even on Binder. And for the longer term reproducibility, once the Conda distribution won't be available, then we also provide the Docker image that might help for the midterm reproducibility. So the idea there is that we break a bit the parallel thing. And the, I mean, a number of experiments like S, Magic, Veritas, and FACT, a prototype for CTA as well, have provided a bit of their data in this DL3 format. So they have created converters in order to convert their data and their instrument response function into the relevant format. And then we were able to produce, to perform a complete multi-instrument analysis with only a few hours. I mean, those are very short amount of data. I mean, it's a few hours only. And we also use the public Fermi data that we adapted so that we can also include it in the analysis. And so now we have this scheme where you convert everything into this data format for gamma rays, DL3. And then you can really use your high level science product on it to produce the data, I mean the scientific results. So this is the kind of things you can do. So here you see a spectrum which is covering more than close to three decades. From the lowest energy, which is mostly covered by Fermi, and then at higher energy, you have MAGIC, then Veritas, then S, which is observing the crab at a relatively large zenith angle, so that the threshold is relatively high. So it is mostly the highest energies. In fact, with its small size, of course, is also the mostly the highest energy. So it provides a very broad energy coverage, and it allows to nicely constrain the spectral shape. For instance, you see the contours of the, so you basically adjust the spectral shape. It's a so-called log parabola, which is a curved power law. And you see that thanks to the broad energy coverage, you can reduce the confident contours of each individual experiment, which you see in green, blue, yellow, and brown, into this much smaller confidence region in red. Thanks to the multi-instrument measurement, and you can go further. You can also perform intercalibrations. Then you can and to really study the possible systematics in the calibration of each instrument. And so here we've simply tested the energy scale uncertainty because since we are using the atmosphere as a calorimeter, of course, depending on the state of the atmosphere, we collect more or less light. And so you expect to have some effects on the actual energy measure depending on the amount of light that you can actually collect. And so you can test that. And you see here that you have a much, you increase a bit the error by introduce these systematics, and you can really measure the apparent error that each instrument is having. And we see that they are more or less within 10% of the absolute measurement for each instrument. We can go further and use make tests on the parent particle population since we can use this open source environment from Python, we can also use packages that allow to do that. And this is shown here. So to conclude, there are no efforts to provide common and open data formats. And we have already prototype for the very high energy gamma ray community. GammaPy is a Python package for the high-level analysis in gamma ray astronomy using this open data format. It's open source and community driven. developed and tested on GitHub. It relies on the open source libraries that are available in the community. It's lightweight and meant to be adaptable. And I showed an example of a reproducible and multi-instrument analysis for the Joint Crab. There are a number of efforts that are there ongoing to increase the support of experiments. So now we should be able to analyze also Hawk data in the near future, which, so Hawk is a different technology than the Cherenkov telescope. So it's interesting to see. And some people, especially in Erlangen, are developing prototype tools to allow for also to support some kind of neutrino analysis and joint neutrino and gamma ray analysis with this tool. And that's what I wanted to say. Thanks.
Thank you, Régis. So we have time for perhaps one short question because we are a bit late. But if there is a question or comments.
No question.
Don't be shy. So, Julien?
Yes, I would have a quick question. So you're talking about a specific format for the gamma ray astronomy. I think it's good within the gamma ray, but now how that would fit within a global interoperable landscape of different messenger. So for example, this format is not used in visible astronomy or gravitational waves. And so now if I want to communicate with you, I would have difficulty because the data format is very different. While FITS, for example, you mentioned FITS. FITS is something common across different messengers. So how would you handle that in practice?
There are two things. There's the format, and we are using FITS, and there's the model, which is indeed dependent on the specific experiment. Of course, we are measuring events, whereas in optics or in radio, you are measuring directly fluxes. So that's totally different. But then, we can follow a number of standards like the one from the IVOA, for instance, and this DL3 format, can be used in this context. I think probably Catherine Boisson will discuss that in more detail later. But of course, this can be then included in the broader scheme of the virtual observatory, for instance. And this actually works. The S data release that follows this this format is available in the in some open observatory environment already.
Thanks.